So this is lecture number 5 in ME303 heat transfer. Till now we've been talking about the introduction part, which was about the modes of heat transfer. So we talked about a bit of a detail on conduction, convection and radiation. And then in the last two lectures, we talked about the relationship between thermodynamics, the first and second laws of thermodynamics and heat transfer. So we saw that instead of talking about the amount of energy exchanged, stored, we'll be talking about the rate at which energy is exchanged or stored. We also talked about the second law of thermodynamics in terms of the heat transfer. So we saw that to ensure the reversibility, the process is to go extremely slowly at a temperature difference of extremely small temperature differences. But there's a trade-off between how reversible you want the process to be, that is how high the efficiency you want, and the rate at which you can extract work from engines. And we will be seeing this again and again, because as engineers, we have to work with energy production a lot, and heat transfers there in almost all energy production processes. So now we'll start talking in detail about the different modes of heat transfer. So the first third of the semester is going to be based on a discussion on heat conduction, which is again an extremely important mode of heat transfer. So let's take an example. So let's take an example of a wall, or let's call it a glass window. So you have a room which has a glass window. So this is the inside part. So let's say it's winters. So the outside temperature T out, and you have inside temperature as T in. And there is going to be some heat loss. So if you have the heaters on, then Ti is higher than T out. And because of the heat losses, because of conduction through this glass window, this is the thickness of the glass window, you will see that there'll be some heat lost, and you would want to minimize this heat lost. And this is how you'll want to design your glass windows, or it could be any other material. It could be your cement wall. But in this case, we're talking about a glass window, for example. So we're interested in how much heat is flowing out in this case. So we'll call this Qx. So X is this direction from left to right. So we'll call the rate at which heat is flowing out, the watts, as Qx in this case. I briefly talked about the Fourier's law of heat conduction. So I mentioned that Fourier gave us a relationship between the heat flux vector and the temperature gradient in that direction. So in the x direction, if we talk about the heat flux, that is watts per meter square, because heat flows through, it's in it flows through the area, it's a surface phenomena. So there's a minus sign here because heat flows from high to low temperature. So if dt is negative, that means you're going from high to low temperature, then heat is positive. Heat flux is positive, and then you have a coefficient of proportionality, the transport coefficient here, which is called the conduction coefficient, the conductivity, thermal conductivity. And we talked about a bit about K as well, as to what the K values are for different solids or fluids, and how this K varies with temperature in some cases. So this is called the Fourier's law of heat conduction. So we call it a law because this is not obtained from first principles. It is actually phenomenological. So you have done experiments, you have seen how Q varies, and this formula, this equation was proposed by Fourier, and it works. Okay. So this is a law. I mean, you can always contradict. If you find a case where this does not work, then you'll have to modify this for a situation where you have a more general relationship, but till now this has been working for us quite well. It's important to understand that this Q is a vector. We won't be putting an arrow on the top, but it is a vector. So that means that it has different components in different directions. In this case, it's a pseudo 1D case because it's the extent in this direction and coming out of the paper, it's a huge window, and the only temperature gradient we see is in the x direction. So that is the case we've written. Well, I should write x here. So this is the Q in the x direction. For a general case where you have a situation where temperature field is not one-dimensional, it's changing in, let's say, all directions. So in that case, the more general form of this Fourier's law of heat conduction is going to be the Q double prime vector. Minus k times grad of t. So this nabla sign is the grad of t, and in a rectangular Cartesian coordinate system, you write your grad of t as this. I mean, you already know that. In continuum mechanics, we started using the E1, E2, and E3 directions. But here, we'll go back to our I, J, and K. But it may happen during the course that I may end up writing grad T as del T by del X1, E1, plus del T by del X2, E2, and del T by del X3, E3. So I'll specify what the directions are, but the labels may change in case I would want to use the initial notation. But in most cases, we'll not do that. But in case I do, and you have any questions, please feel free to ask. But people who have done continuum mechanics will be comfortable with either notation. Okay. So as an example, let us take a situation where you have, let's say you have a wire, a cylindrical electrical wire. And it has an insulation on top of it. The insulation's some sort of polymer that is so you have covered the wire with an insulation. So if we look at if there's some joule heating happening in the wire, so because of the current flow the wire is getting hotter, you will see that the temperature of the wire will be high, and then outside, let us say it's a cold day, so the temperature outside is low. So what will happen is that you will see some temperature field getting developed. So if I look at the cross-sectional view, so what I see is, let's create some more space here. So if I look at the cross-sectional view, so I will see that if I here I'm drawing the temperature contours, so they'll be concentric circles. So that means that the temperature, so these are isotherms. So if this is how the isotherms are, and you have high temperature inside, so this is T1, let's say T2 and T3, three contours, and T1 greater than T2 is greater than T3. So in this case, your grad of T in this situation will be from radially outwards. So your grad T will point radially outward. And that is what the direction of heat flux vector will be. So you will need to brush up your vector calculus here, because we'll be working with wires a lot. You'll see that you'll be working with your radial coordinates and so on. We'll also be calculating a lot of gradients and Laplacians and so on. So you'll have, I'll suggest on Moodle, I have uploaded the first week's reading assignment, and that includes a couple of sections on vector calculus from your engineering mathematics. So please make sure you revise that. I'm sure you have learned about vector calculus either in the continuum mechanics course or in your electrodynamics course or the mathematics course. So please do revise that. And I've recommended you the book by Krasick, which is quite standard for engineering mathematics for engineers. So this is all I wanted to say about Fourier's law. Now it may happen that sometimes you would, I mean, although the direction of heat flux is calculated like this, but you would want to find out the component of that in a particular direction. Okay. So again, there's nothing new here. So in case you want to find the component of your heat flux in a given direction, all you do is, let's say you want to find out the component in n hat direction, then all you do is you take q double prime vector dot n. So that gives you the component or the amount of heat transfer in that particular direction n hat that is of interest. And this, through the ideas of vector calculus, if I use 1, then this becomes minus k, and you have grad t dot n, which is nothing but minus k del t by del n. Okay, so you should understand what del t by del n means, which is the same as grad t dot the n vector. All right. Any questions on this? So mathematically, the two quantities of interest, which are related to each other in this course, at least while talking about conduction, are your temperature fields and the heat flux vector field. So what that means is, you would want to find out for a given situation, if you can find out the temperature field, that is T as a function of x, y, z, and t. So temperature at all times, all positions in space, that gives you everything you need, because from this you can then calculate your q vector, q heat flux vector, which is minus k grad of this t. So this vector is also a field, so we call it the heat flux vector field, because it is a function of time and position coordinate. I'll also sometimes write simply t as a function of position vector x and t. So again, we have seen this in previous courses in engineering, the idea of using a position vector to find the position at which we are trying to find the temperature. So mathematically, our aim in heat transfer is to find this temperature field. So we'll have to somehow write an equation for this temperature, so temperature is the unknown in the equation, and we'll solve that equation. And this equation is something that we'll derive just now for heat conduction. So if I can write that equation and solve it, then it will give me the temperature value at all points in space and time. And that will mean that the job's done. Mathematically, all I have to do then is to analyze this temperature field and extract useful information for my design criteria. All right, so now we'll derive the equation for heat conduction, which will also be called the heat equation. Okay, so this equation will have the temperature field as the unknown, which the equation can then be solved to get the temperature field. That is the aim of this exercise. The heat conduction equation. So heat conduction equation is nothing but an energy balance equation. You're simply doing an energy balance. So let's take a situation. So you have, let's say, a domain. So when I say a domain, that means that it could be your glass window that we just talked about. And you take an elemental volume inside this domain. I'm drawing it a bit small, but it's simply a cube that I have drawn inside this domain. So this is an elemental volume, and we'll be doing all our analysis on this elemental volume. So it's an energy balance. You may have seen this many times. So if I take my, let's use a different color. So we have our x, y, and z direction. So I'll call this one x, this one y, and the one going up as z. So this is our right-handed coordinate system, and this is our elemental volume. Of course, I've expanded that a lot to write my vector, heat flux vectors. So in this case, what's happening is that there is some heat that is getting conducted in and conducted out of this volume, because we're talking about conduction. So you will have some heat. We'll call it Qx in the x direction. And on the right hand side, we'll call it Qx plus delta x. So this volume has dimensions of delta x, delta y, and delta z. So the volume for this cube V is delta x, delta y, and delta z. Okay. Similarly, in the y direction, you have heat conducting into the volume as Q y, and this is z. And heat getting conducted out is Q at Z plus delta Z. So the subscript here is used for, I'm also putting the position here, but you could also write it as Q at Z plus delta Z, okay, as a function. It's up to you. I mean, it's just a representation. In this case, I'm trying to stay consistent with the book, so that in case you read the textbook, the notation is consistent. Okay, and then in the y direction, you have heat that's conducting in as Qy, and heat that is conducting out as Q at y plus delta y. Okay, so this is the energy in and energy out. And then it could happen that some energy is being generated inside this elemental volume. So we'll call that Eg with a dot on top, because we're talking about rates here. And the net effect would result in some increase or decrease in the energy stored. So we'll call that E stored dot. We're not considering any mechanical work done in this case. So this is all we have in terms of the energy balance. Of course, if the situation was different, you could have a modification for this equation. But let us assume that this is all we have in this situation. Okay, so let's write the energy balance now. So what we do is, since Q is a function of X, Y, Z, and T, so we can write, so this is a so this is Q as a function of X plus delta X. So using my Taylor series expansion, since Q is a function of X, so I can write QX plus delta X as approximately equal to QX plus del QX by del X times delta X. Is this part of the board, is this font visible? Is there anyone who has problems reading this font? Okay, so I've simply written Q at X plus delta X as using Taylor series. So that's approximately equal to QX plus del by del X of QX times delta X. And I've neglected the higher order terms in delta X squared and above because they are much smaller than the this leading term, which has an order of delta X. Okay, similarly, I can write that for my Y and Z directions as well. So Q at Y plus delta Y is approximately QY plus del Q by del Y at Y times delta Y, and Q at Z plus delta Z is approximately equal to QZ plus del Q by del Z of Z at Z times delta Z. Okay, so this is based on Taylor series expansion. So next, let's write the energy generation term. Should we mention, let's just mention using Taylor series. Okay, next is your EG term, EG dot. So if you remember, I mentioned that energy generation usually is talked in terms of volumetric energy generation. So we will write this EG dot, which is in watts, as some Q dot. It's a new symbol that I'm using. It's not related to my Q. So it's again, just to be consistent with the book. So Q dot is energy generation per unit volume. And then I multiply that, this is delta V, times delta V. So I just write energy generation, rate of energy generation as some energy generation per unit volume multiplied by the volume in this case. Okay, it's typical to do that because energy generation is a volumetric phenomena. Okay, the next one is energy stored. So when the energy gets stored in a system, then its internal energy will increase. Now the internal energy can increase either as one, sensible heating, that is the temperature will increase, or secondly as latent heat. In this case, we'll assume that there's no phase change. So all the energy that gets stored or depleted is simply changing the temperature inside this elemental volume. So if you have lots of heat entering and very less heat leaving, then you will see that the temperature inside the system will increase. Okay? So we will write this stored energy using my the ideas, the mass contained in the system, that's delta M. It's a solid, so we'll just write Cp, because Cp is equal to Cv for solids. And then you have your delta T by this is a dot on top. So here we have the change in temperature with time. Okay. So the mass in this case is not changing. If the mass was changing, then you'll have d by dt of mcp delta mcp dt. But in this case, that is not the case. So we have the mass fixed in the system. So delta M times Cp times the rate of change of temperature with time. So partial derivative. Okay, this delta M can be written as, we're assuming that the density of the fluid is fixed. Okay, so this is simply density times the volume. So this delta M can be replaced as rho times delta V. So I hope that this is clear now. Let's do the energy balance now. I'll do it on the right hand side of the board. So the energy balance equation is the energy stored, well, the rate of energy stored is equal to the rate at which energy is entering minus the rate at which energy is leaving plus the rate at which energy is getting generated. So let me check if this part of the board is visible to you. Yeah, well, there's plenty of space on the right as well. Okay. Okay, so that's my energy balance equation. So all I have to do now is to substitute these terms, this part for energy stored, rate of energy stored, for the energy in Qx, Qy, and Qz are the energy in terms, and Qx plus delta x, Qz plus delta z, and Qy plus delta y are the energy out terms. So we'll simply substitute those. So I've written the first three terms are energy in, so Qx plus Qy plus Qz, and the next three terms are the energy out, Qx plus delta x, Qy plus delta y, and Qz plus delta z, and the energy generation dot can be written as Q dot times delta V. And the left hand side actually was rho delta V Cp del T by del time. Okay, so let's see if we can squeeze that here. Okay. Sorry, I didn't have enough space. I didn't plan that. But this is rho times delta V times Cp times dou T by dou time. Any questions on this? So now I can simply substitute these expressions I have here and simplify the expression on the left hand side. So rho times delta V remains the same. So I'll just keep it rho delta V Cp dou temperature by dou time. On the right, I use the Taylor series expansion. So I'll see that Qx, Qy, and Qz will cancel out. And all I'll be left with is minus del Qx by del x times delta x. Actually, these were, was it correct? To make sure that we are still talking about watts. So I've got the three terms which appeared from the expansion of the Taylor series expansion of this Qx plus delta x and so on. And then I have the last term, which is Q dot times delta V. Okay. Now, remember, we are trying to write the equation for temperature field. So the next thing we can do is I can write my Qx, Qy, and Qz in terms of my Fourier's law of heat conduction. So that law can be used now. and I can write my qx. Should we write that here? So I'll use the part below the board just for writing the equations, which I'll be substituting on the right hand side. So we have qx as minus k times del temperature by del x. Okay. Then I have my qy as minus k del t by del y, and so on. Well, let's write qz as well. So these are the expressions for qx, qy, and qz. So if you substitute that here and divide by delta v throughout, so what we end up getting is rho now we have a minus sign, so that minus sign gets cancelled, and this is delta x. Oh sorry, there is an area as well, I missed that. This k times a, let's write it properly. So you have minus k times, then you have the area. So the area is the cross-sectional area. So if you're talking about the x direction heat transfer, then the cross-sectional area is delta y delta z. Similarly, for the heat that's flowing in the y direction, you have minus k times the cross-sectional area, which is delta x delta z. So when we substitute these expressions here, so you'll see that in qx term, you have a delta x already there, then you have delta y delta z, so that becomes delta v. So when we divide by delta v, then delta v is cancelled. So qx is k times I guess you can still see this part of the board. I won't write any further than this. Okay, so this is my equation, and then we also have a q dot. And delta v gets cancelled because we have divided the complete equation by delta v. Okay, so that is it. So we have obtained an equation for the temperature feed. So density is known to us. Cp again is a property of the solid or the fluid, whatever it is. So that's again known to us. Temperature is an independent variable here. X, Y, and Z also are independent variables. We're trying to find the value of temperature as a function of X, Y, Z, and T. K again is a property of the material and the temperature. So again, that is known to us. We don't have to solve for it. And Q dot. Q dot is the energy generation. So depending on the physical phenomena that's causing energy generation, Q dot is also that is a known function or a constant. So Q dot is given to us as well. So all we see is that we have an equation for temperature. It's a partial differential equation. We have to figure out a way to solve this. And if we can solve this, then we have solved for the temperature. And then we can find the value of the heat flux, or sorry, the rate of heat transfer as using these Fourier law of heat conduction. Any questions? There's a question by Abhishek. Should E in and E out, so the E in dot and E out, should they not be zero as there is no velocity? So no mass is entering or leaving, just heat is flowing, right? So E is nothing to do with velocity. So remember, we talked about the mechanism of conduction. So in solids, you don't need the molecules to flow. So let's say a non-metallic solid. So the energy transfer is happening through lattice vibrations. So the molecules on the left are jiggling because of, let's say, it's at high temperature. And then they in turn vibrate the molecules to the right of it and the energy transfer. So this is a diffusion process or the conduction process, which has nothing to do with the molecules flowing as a bulk. So don't confuse that E in because of the mass flow rate. Okay, this is just the rate of energy transfer because of conduction. We're talking about conduction now. I hope this explanation is clear. So please don't confuse, E in dot later when we talk about general situations, E in dot will contain all sort of contributions. It will contain the effect of conduction, the molecules hitting. It could also include some convection. So if you're talking about fluid has both conduction and convection happening if the fluid is flowing. It is also conducting heat. At the same time, it's also fluid is flowing as a bulk and transferring heat. So both the phenomena may be happening. So in that case, you'll have to add more terms to it. But in this case, we assume that it's pure conduction, no bulk flow happening inside this. But this is solid any case. So it's simply lattice vibrations causing the heat conduction. Any other questions? Okay, so we have obtained our heat conduction equation. So this equation we'll call heat conduction equation. It is also called diffusion equation. Because the mathematical expression is very similar to what we use in diffusion, the gradient. So we use the gradient transfer law here. Fourier's law of heat conduction is nothing but the gradient flow law. So the flow happens, or the something flows because of the gradient or change of temperature. It is also called the heat equation. Sometimes you will see that they just write heat equation. Okay, so you'll see these terms being used interchangeably, so don't get confused. Now, since we understand vector calculus, we can simplify this equation into a more condensed form. Let's see how. So we can, on the left hand side, it still stays the same. So we have rho Cp del temperature by del time. On the right hand side, what I can do is I can write this as the gradient of, the divergence of k times grad temperature. Okay, so this term, divergence of k grad t, contains all these three terms. Okay. So remember that k grad t is a vector, it has three components, and this grad is a vector operator, but when you take the divergence, it's a dot product, so you end up getting we end up getting del by del x of k del t by del x, and so on, a sum of all those. Okay, so I won't go into detail. This is your vector calculus 101. So you should be able to understand that. If you, if not, then you brush up your vector calculus skills. All right. Now, you would see that I have not taken k out of this differential. So I have not assumed anything yet. I've not assumed that k is homogeneous. I've not assumed that k is the same everywhere in the material. It could happen that k was different at different spatial points. So I've not assumed anything, but if your k was homogeneous, let's see if I have more space on the board. if my K is homogeneous, I can take this K out. So what I'm left with is can see that this becomes the Laplacian of T grad square T, which is nothing but del 2 temperature by del x squared plus del 2 temperature by del y squared plus del 2 temperature by del z squared. Okay, so that's a special case, and if that is the case, then you can. So this is the most general form, and this is one special case that we have considered. Any questions? Okay, now what we'll do is we will divide all sides by rho Cp. Okay. And this quantity, this coefficient of Laplacian of T that you have here is called the thermal diffusivity. Okay, so we define another term here. Well, let's write it. Again, the idea comes from your mathematical diffusion equation. So in the diffusion equation, of course, once you ensure that the coefficient of del temperature by del T is 1, then the coefficient of your Laplacian of T is called the diffusion coefficient. So this is the diffusion term. Then the coefficient of that is called the diffusion coefficient. Okay, so we call it the thermal diffusivity. That's from the mathematical side. Well, since the definition, so I'll put three lines here. Okay, now let's try to understand what this means. So this is the ratio of thermal conductivity and rho Cp. So thermal conductivity is how easily the heat can flow, heat can conduct into the through the material. And rho Cp is the storage. Okay, so the more rho Cp value is, the more energy that can be stored in this infinitesimal volume. Okay, I'm sure you understand that. So the ratio of this, let's say that this ratio is very high. So that would mean either the K value is high or rho Cp is low. So what that means is that when heat gets, heat flows through the material, it does not store much. It quickly diffuses to the right hand side, okay, or whatever direction you're talking about. And if this value is low, the alpha value is low, which could either be that either the K is low, the conduction rate is low, or your rho Cp is high. So what that means is that the if heat enters, then it takes the rate at which it diffuses is slow. Okay, so if your rho Cp was high, that means that it will end up storing a lot of energy, and the energy will not flow out of this infinitesimal volume. I have to make sure I finish on time, because that was one of the feedbacks from you last time. Okay, so I only have two more minutes. I'll finish in 2 minutes. Any questions?
Sir, like if K is low and if rho Cp is also low, but K is so low that it overall makes alpha low.
It can happen.
In that case, the energy storage capacity of the material or the infinitesimal volume is low. Still, we are getting a flow which is impeded or like very slow flow. So, like it gives me a feeling that K and rho Cp are related, because if
they are not, they are two independent things. Okay. So that intuition that you have, you'll have to wait for more time in this course. and well, calibrate your intuition when you solve problems. But K is not, so rho is density, Cp is specific heat, and K is the thermal conductivity. They're all independent quantities. They are not related to each other. But ultimately, it's the alpha that matters when we talk about the rate at which the heat is diffusing into the system or through the system.
So how do we like explain that if the capacity is very low and still we are getting low speed, low heat transfer rates?
No, it's not heat transfer, it's the diffusion. So heat transfer, again, depends on your heat transfer does not depend on rho and Cp.
Yeah, okay,
don't confuse that. So give it some time and then it will become clear.
Okay.
So you have to answer this question by yourself when you go through problems and more experience. Okay, so I will just talk about a couple of special cases and then stop. So these special cases are used a lot. I won't write that. I'll write that again next time. So one's called steady state. Okay, steady state means that things do not change with time. Okay, it's steady. It's typically, again, yesterday's problem of the wind turbine nacelle. So we said that initially it goes to a transient state. When you switch on the turbine, the nacelle starts heating up. And as it heats up, the rate at which it is losing heat to the atmosphere is also increasing because delta T is increasing. And it reaches that steady state after which the temperature inside the nacelle does not change. That means whatever's entering is equal to whatever's leaving. So steady state means nothing changes with time. So your del temperature by del T is zero. It's not a function of time anymore. So in steady state situations, your del temperature by del T becomes zero. So that's one special case. The other one is when the generation is zero. Of course, I mean, that is possible. We just wrote a general case. It could happen that there is nothing inside this volume causing generation of heat. So in that case, Q dot will be zero. We'll talk about more about details of the application of this equation and try to solve it on Wednesday in our on Thursday in our next class. So I'll switch off the recording now. And in case you have any questions, please feel free to ask.